has a new footing job in Edmond, Oklahoma. The way I understand it, this is going to be a pretty big project. We got a, these are going to be apartments. Big project. Then across the street to the left here, there's going to be another set of apartments with a big parking garage. So there'll be some big footings on that one. But this one here, these footings are pretty. The worst part about these are cut up. They're up and down on the elevation a bunch. Be jumping up and down on the grade. We're trying to get grade figured out. I think this one's only 8 inches deep. But I'm not sure where 8 inches starts, so. We're gonna get all this sorted out and we'll get going here in a minute. Started here finally. We got a little box out footing here that comes from the deep part of the building pad to the shallow part. And these footings are really shallow. The squat footings are a little bit deeper. But we're going to go ahead and take this chunk of dirt out of the middle here. They don't need that in there. Build a wall in there to hold that up, so try to do this without making too much of a mess. Probably gonna have to clean out some other ditches here in a minute, but about the only way I knew to dig this out without losing layout, that's the way I did it. And then this is pretty simple stuff, just 2 foot wide, 8 inches deep. The long teeth on the outside edge of the bucket, I got brand new teeth on. And when you're digging this crusty, dried out stuff, it's best to have some pretty nice teeth on the outside edges. They gotta be pretty sharp to make it work. A lot of guys I see digging, they don't keep the teeth changed out, and it makes a big, big difference. And the teeth might not even literally look wore out, but even though, it doesn't take much, when they get rounded off a little bit, they don't have that nice, sharp edge on them. They just will not dig a decent ditch, especially, it really shows up in this dried out crust. But actually, this stuff's turning out better than I thought it might. It's kind of trashy. This is an old, I'm sure there probably used to be some houses in here or something. So, not the greatest dirt underneath. There's, and even the slack field's got a few rocks in it here and there. So, just make the best we can with it, with what we got. We could plow through here and blow this stuff up and make a mess. And I know I get comments all the time. Everybody tells me how great the dirt is. The dirt is good, don't get me wrong, but you could still make a mess out of this. I mean, I've seen it done. I promise you, when the plumber gets started out here, you'll see. Usually the plumber don't really care about how neat the ditches are. So we'll probably get a comparison before the job's over, or different types of digging. say this is decent dirt. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying I'm the only one that can do this, but I'm just saying that it could be worse. It could turn out to be a disaster if not handled properly. So, and it really doesn't take that much longer to dig it right, because you're actually moving less dirt. I got that little mound shaped up there. It didn't turn out too bad. I kind of filled in my spot footing there, but I can dip it out before I get turned back around here. Anyway, I got this ditch deer man moving dirt. 333G deer. Just keep on digging, I guess, till we get her done. Anyway, just plugging along, being old bee. You kind of see, I've talked about it before, if you kind of keep your teeth straight up and down, or maybe laid to the back a little bit when you're doing that first cut, it gives your bucket a chance to roll up over those rocks a little bit, and kind of peel them out of there, roll them out without blowing up the ditch. But it doesn't always work, depending on where the rock's at. If it's right in the side of the ditch, it doesn't matter. It's gonna blow it out. But you can sometimes save them. We got a spot right there that's just really tough. If you keep your teeth kind of, like I say, straight up and down, or laid back a little bit, and try to do a long cut, don't just try to fill your bucket up. You're not going to get a full bucket every time. You don't need to. Not loading trucks here. We're just digging a ditch, a deep one. Sometimes people think the name of the dirt game is always about production, moving as much dirt as possible. Well, sometimes, like in this case, it's leaving as much dirt as you can there. Because we're making concrete forms, and told me that concrete's $150 a yard right now. That is ridiculously high. But everything's got, you know, everything's going up with the inflation we've got. And you can't just blame it on a big business to say, hey, we're raising our prices. It's not their fault. They have to pay more for material, they have to pay more for fuel. Their profits are probably actually going down when they're handling more money than they've ever handled. So, anyway. This is kind of the side effect of when the government decides it just needs to print money all day, every day. Throw it away. Just turn it into trash. Toilet paper. Anyway, shallow ditches are hard to make look neat. If you can make a shallow ditch look nice, it's great. You've actually accomplish something, because you gotta really leave the edges on. Like I say, it's hard to do in some circumstances. Sometimes it works out. Well, I guess they do have a crew of rock busters over our time steel today, so. They're getting some stuff done. It's just like, what is that? Is that a ditch or just a low spot on the bed? Another technique, and I've talked about this before, is on the first couple passes, if you can alternate your bucket back and forth, like leaning, swinging over one side about an inch, and on the next pass, swing it over the other side about an inch. You won't really see it when the ditch is done. It'll be a little bit wider to top, but it still turns out better than if you blow the sides out of it. And I'm probably exaggerating. I may not be going over more than a half an inch each way, but that extra bit of clearance you leave in there makes a big difference in how it digs, how say you hit a rock or something like that, it just throws it, you know, instead of throwing everything way out of whack, it can have a little room to move around in there. They got dang good compaction on this dirt, I'll say that about it. And when they did it, this actually here is not that dry, so they must have got it about right on the moisture. To keep the good dirt down under this stuff is some black nasty stuff. We're going to try to keep it separated out best we can. And you can kind of see we got a little bit mixed up there on top. It's pretty hard to keep it all exactly separate. Anyway, it just kind of looks like I'm not getting nothing done here. It's the procedure you got to use in certain kinds of dirt. And, you know, people tell me I'll dig a ditch and it'll be a complicated, hard ditch, and the dirt won't be great. Then people say, "Man, you got the best dirt I've ever seen." It's like, you don't understand. The dirt is what you make it. I have to adjust digging techniques. It's not all the same. It's not like I come out here, stick a bucket in the ground and it magically turns out pretty. Must have got that other a little bit deep. Looks like shallow ditches are pretty hard to keep grade on too, because they're shallow. There's techniques you can use, there's things you can do to improve your dirt or how it turns out. it's not all about the material you're working in, it's about how you treat it. Just throw your hands up and say this dirt's crap. You're not gonna learn nothing. It's gonna look like crap if you're done. So even though the dirt might be crap, you gotta look at it and say, well, let's do the best we can. We'll figure out a technique that works. Like I say, the best thing, my best advice is new teeth on the outside corners. The middle ones don't matter. In fact, I think in this type of stuff, if those middle ones are a little bit shorter than your outside ones, you're better off. You'll get better results. So that's a given almost any footing job you do. Try to keep some good teeth in the truck in case you need them. And then, like I say, your setup, keeping things straight, neat. Try to widen that top just a little bit out. You can kind of see I got a rock right there that threw me off course. And that happens. It happens less if you take small cuts. It happens a lot more if you try to take too much. There's rocks in the ditch, and there's always going to be something bumping your bucket back and forth. Another thing I always hear, you know, people always say, that's a really tight machine, man. I wish mine was that tight. Well, you got to know how to dig with a loose machine. Believe it or not, this one's not the tightest in the world. It just looks like it because I grew up running wore out stuff, so you gotta understand how to make junk work. You can't always have a brand new machine on a job. Fact is, the old broke-in machines will get you further than the new ones. I think we just about got B broke in. We got 12,000 hours on her, a little more than that. She's doing a good job. I do have a little slack in the swing on it. There's slack in the main boom bushings. Slack in the pivot. I've replaced a lot of them, but I've still got some that are just not great. Says we're good, we're gonna go ahead. I'm gonna lean over to the left of that ditch just a little bit and kind of trim that side up, make it look better. Go ahead, crumb the edges. Like a piece of cake, piece of pie, whatever it is, the easiest pie. These footings are so shallow, I don't have a clue. The exterior footings are deeper. I think they're about 3 foot. Maybe they're not. Maybe they're 18. They're not very deep either. No matter. Deep or shallow, we'll dig it. Camera or feel it, but I can feel rocks pretty much since that it's not nice, not going to come out good. Anyway, guys say that, I've had more than a couple say that they learned something from me watching. And that's kind of one reason I do it. I've also had some guys say, well, you're giving away all your secrets. And my response to that is if you learn something from my channel and you put it to use, you're going to make the world a better place by digging nice ditches. I don't really care if you're my competition or not. I like to see people do good. It's rare. And, you know, that's another thing I tell people that say, well, you're giving away your secrets. Like, well, most people wouldn't put them to use anyway. They're lazy. They don't want to. They get on a machine, they get out in the dirt, and they gotta hurry all the time. They think everything's a race. Not if you're digging footings. It might be if you're loading semis or haul trucks, moving thousands of yards a day. That's you gotta hustle, and you gotta keep full buckets. You gotta be efficient. Like I say, efficiency is different on footing work. I don't run the backhoe wide open. A lot of people say you should run the backhoe faster. Well, I don't see the need to. I can run it faster, but for doing this type of work, it's kind of pointless. Because you're going to end up making a mess, and you're going to cost them. You might cost them a little more time digging the footing, but you're going to save money in concrete. There's always waste on footings. There's always a percentage of amount. There's a percentage of dirt or concrete that's going to get wasted. It's a given. But if you can reduce that enough, a little bit more time digging the footing right, it's going to pay off. Work's not good for me. I get paid by the hour, so if it takes me just a little bit longer to dig a footing, leaves you cut the concrete, it's a win-win. I don't get many complaints saying I'm slow. I've got some comments on videos that say, yeah, it looks like it takes you forever to do a job. Well, if I wasn't decent at it, I probably wouldn't have a channel or a YouTube channel or a job where that I could show you how I dig footings. I mean, I've been digging footings for 30 years. I'm 50 years old, and my first job I did was for my dad when I was 20. So, I think I've been at it enough to know a little bit about what I don't know at all, and like I tell people, I'm not the best operator there is. There's always one better out there. That don't mean you gotta make his job easy though. You gotta make him work. If he's gonna be better or she's gonna be better, you gotta make him work for him. You gotta make him earn it. We got the horsepower, we can pull through there. Probably nearly cut down the grade in one pass. But boy, we'd have a mess. So I guess this is gonna look kind of like a pitchfork out here. I don't know what this dumpster pad or what this is. It's kind of weird. Surely not. This is inside the courtyard of the apartment. I think there's a courtyard maybe. I don't know how they do that. It's a big rectangle shaped building. Quite a bit to it. Stops right there for some reason. I don't know what the deal is. But yeah, another question I get a lot is, when are you going to replace your backhoe, and what will you replace it with? And those are questions I don't really know the answer to. I mean, right now, my plan is maybe run this one another year or two. And then we'll probably be looking for something pre-owned. I don't think I'll buy a brand new one. I don't. If you can find one that's already lost a little bit on depreciation, you're better off, in my opinion. A decent machine with low hours or whatever. Works out good for everybody. Skid steer guy going here. But as far as the brand of backhoe, that's going to kind of depend on what I can find. I mean, I'd not be opposed to switching brands. Although, many people probably don't think they're worth buying, but I think New Holland has a pretty dang neat machine. I mean, we're setting it over 12,000 hours, and this thing has really done a good job. I mean, it's had problems, it's, you know. But the engine, as far as the engine goes, it's never been into. Running the original, everything. I mean, knock on wood, it's still going. So, I did have to change the hydraulic pump once on it. That wasn't because it wore out, it had a crack, and I think it probably had a crack from the factory. But it didn't show up until we got, can't remember if I was sitting around 6,000, 7,000, maybe 8,000 hours when that happened. But anyway, put a new pump on it. No trouble since then. I've had to repack cylinders on it. That's just kind of normal stuff when you use them. So, is there a better backhoe? There may be a better one out there, I don't know. The thing about them is they're all a little different, and they all got, I think all of them have a little quirk that I don't like, and it's hard to find that one that, once you're used to running one. This backhoe has a good air conditioner. I don't have to have tinted windows to stay cool in the summer. I mean, tinted windows look cool, yeah, they're neat looking, but you can't see how it works for you. Or at least an old blind man like me can, so. But anyway, I'll be buying something. I really hope that I can keep this one. I mean, I'd really like to keep B as a standby or a second machine where it could go out and be on a job, you know, like maybe far away from home, and I wouldn't have to move it back and forth as much, and or maybe the new one will do that. I guess we'll see. Another thing about buying a different brand is the buckets are different, which big part of the cost of owning a backhoe is your bucket. So I could sure, if I kept the same machine, I could sure buckets pretty easy. Or if I got a pin grabber, I could probably use them anyway. So there's options on that stuff. It's nothing set in stone. There's nothing that says I'm a diehard two-hauling guy. If a right deal came along, I'd probably buy it.
Summertime, it's hot. When I get home, I usually don't feel like messing with it.